Isolde, however, rails against Tristan and then sends Brangaena to him. The hero is commanded to appear before the princess. Three times Brangaena is rebuffed. If Tristan were to leave his post, who would then steer the ship home? Corvinal has little time for such niceties. Brutally, he reminds Isolde's ambassador that the hero Tristan is lord of the world. Who was it, after all, who killed Sir Morold? Sent back to her mistress empty-handed, Brangaena pulls the curtains round the tent, shutting out the mocking sailors. And Isolde, furiously, launches into an extended narration. How she and Tristan came to find themselves on this ship bound for Cornwall. How Tristan slew Morold. How Isolde was about to kill the wounded Tristan, having matched a sword splinter taken from Morold's head with a notch in Tristan's weapon. How Tristan then glanced at Isolde, and how Isolde relented. Here's a wonderful dramatic opportunity for the soprano who sings the role of Isolde, and one that rises to a blood-chilling climax when she curses Tristan and longs for death for both of them. Think of the honour that Tristan has done you, pleads Brangaena, claiming you as bride for the King of Cornwall. But Isolde is deaf to arguments about honour. How could I endure the torture of being unloved and seeing the noblest of men so close to me? Here at last is the truth openly admitted. Isolde loves Tristan. Brangaena continues. And if there were any man who didn't love Isolde, then he could be made to. Isolde's mother has packed a casket with balsam for wounds, antidotes for poisons, and a love potion. But Isolde points to another phial in the casket, the draught that delivers death. The sailors have sighted land, and Tristan sends word that Isolde is to prepare herself for King Mark. Not, she says, until the hero has first begged her forgiveness. And with an imperious wave, she orders Brangaena to prepare a drink of atonement. Tristan approaches. Why has he kept his distance during this voyage? Demands Isolde. He says it was to show her respect. It's the custom of his country. There is an Irish custom, Isolde replies, to make atonement with an enemy whom you wish to make a friend of. There is the unfinished business of Sir Morold's death. If Morold meant so much to you, then kill the enemy who stands before you, says Tristan. And with this, he offers her his sword. No, replies Isolde, they will end the feud with a drink of atonement. Tristan instantly understands what this atonement really means. He's being offered death by poison. The only balm for endless grief and oblivion's kind draught, I drink you without flinching. And Tristan raises the cup and drinks. Half is mine, cries Isolde, seizing the cup. Traitor, I drink to you. Brangaena has substituted the love potion for the poison. And now the lovers openly admit what they have always felt but kept hidden, their rapturous love. They see and hear nothing but each other. Not Brangaena, who is struggling to prepare the royal bride, not Corvinal saluting his hero, not the sailors hailing King Mark as his boat draws alongside.
Oh,
there, above the shouts of the sailors as the curtain falls on Act One, is Isolde's love motif.